The Baroda University was the first in India to have teaching of art at university level. The person who started it, he had studied in USA art education at Philadelphia Barnes Foundation. So it was a good kind of a curriculum he came up, where he used some system which was used by old British art schools. And they were preparing, teaching mainly skills, and the kind of skills that can be used for their own, their means Britishers use. So there were many artists after independence who had the opportunity of going mainly to Europe and had seen what was happening. They were very unhappy about the situation in art education in India. And they were all looking forward. So when University of Baroda started this, everyone welcomed and everyone supported it wholeheartedly. In spite of lots of local political pressures, the dean who started, Markand Bhatt, and the vice chancellor of university, they were strong enough to sustain their own policy against all politics. So instead of having only artists from Gujarat, they had best painters and teachers available from anywhere in the India. No, that was their main. And that's how we could get Professor Bendre, Shankar Chaudhary, and Subramanian. If we had only artists from Gujarat, we would have been nowhere. So they used everything, Western, old British schools, what was happening in Japan, in Shantiniketan. Since it was a very small institution, we had a one-to-one relationship. And since there were no other university where they had similar courses, we were getting students from all over India. Eventually, later, this political, local political pressure started increasing. So there are now more students from Gujarat. What happens that those who come from outside, they wouldn't come all the way to Baroda unless they are really interested. Well, those who are here, Gujarat, like myself, I came here because I had no other place where I could have gone. It's very unfortunate, but the number of women students is much more, because their parents want their daughters to have some kind of degree, doesn't matter which degree. And degree is important for settling their marriage, because still 95% of marriages are settled by parents. It's only during last 10-15 years that some women graduate from our fine arts college continued working in art. Otherwise, most of the students who, women students who were my co-students, hardly anybody is doing anything, because then they become housewives. But when I was there, I insisted that we should have a woman teacher. Though it was not accepted by university, I said we must have, because when we have so many women students, I mean, there should be somewhere where they feel little more open to discuss certain things, which a young girl would never come to me and talk about certain problems. No, this is the main difference between Indian students or Indians and people in the USA. No, there people are very frank. Here, being frank is considered being impolite. The whole concept of frankness is connected with being, that you are not well educated, or what is it called, ill-educated. You do what you are told to do, and something like that. We are the greatest hypocritic people in India. We consider a woman goddess, not only mother, and treat the worst at the other end. We also burn and call her Sati, and again take that status after burning to a goddess. So lots of double standards, or maybe so many in between. I was student for 9 years, 6 years regular course. Then there was 1 year empty in between. I continued in college, and then I got another grant from Government of India. So again I worked under Professor Bendre for 2 years, so 9 years. Then I became teacher, and I also realized that, you know, pretending to be a teacher, I was actually learning more. Within a year or two, I also realized that my interests were very limited, you know, and narrow. But students had so many different interests. And in order to help them, I had to understand those things which otherwise had never interested me. I liked photography. I had, especially, I had seen that exhibition, Family of Men. And I thought it was a great thing, you know, and what photography could do, especially in terms of communication, no? But visually. In 1967, there was one seminar in Bombay, Mumbai, on folklore. And the people who organized it knew Ghulam Mohammad Sheikh and Bhupen Kakkar. So they convinced them that folklore should also have visual art, not only, you know, the oral traditions of songs and stories. Folklore should include the whole gamut of, you know, folk culture. And they agreed. So they asked us to collect things for it. But while doing that, I realized that many things that I had seen when I was a young child were not there anymore. And fortunately, I had a friend. He was teaching at the UCLA. He had a project of documentation of Indian culture. But they granted a small grant for, you know, as a pilot project to see whether it was worth. So for two and a half years, we worked together. You know. So I learnt a lot. With him, we travelled only in Gujarat. But later I continued. And whenever I got any opportunity, I went everywhere. Most of the things I have photographed are not there anymore. So I am happy that I could do at least that much. You know, we have a saying in Gujarati, Annatevo Odkar, it means when you burp, it has a smell, usually smell, not fragrance, of whatever you have eaten. So you can't control. It's directly related. It can't be controlled at all. Similarly, whatever I have seen, read, heard, understood, rightly or wrongly, like, you know, face in a crowd. I mean, I thought I understood it, which was exactly opposite of the real meaning. And still I used it as a fuel, and I'm still happy with it. Now, since I know, I find it more amusing. I had heard this term when, you know, I was in New York. Then I found that even a young child would call me just Choti. You know. We add bhai or ben, which is almost equivalent of Mr. or Sir. Only my mother called me Jyoti. So I was feeling very different, you know, that I was not what I was in India. You know, I realized what I really was. I was so different in look, physically. So everyone knew me, that here is the guy, you know, from India. So they would say, hi, hi. So I realized that they know me only by face. They don't know who I am, not even name, or in which department I am working. I am just a face. It shattered the kind of artificial glory I had about myself. You know, I mean, it was a revelation in a way, enlightenment almost. A face. Only possibility was left, facing left and right. And then I also realized that that itself created, gave a meaning, because left had a political meaning and right had cultural or political meaning. I could see that this, the change of meaning, I found it very interesting. When I went to USA, I'm jumping here and there, you know, like ping pong, but I was supposed to stay with one American family. As a part of orientation, so we have less cultural shock. I was asked whether I had any problem and things that I see, I could see there, you know, shocked me. I said not much, because, you know, in India we had seen too many Hollywood films, which gave us fairly good idea of what is happening. And then I said I had also read Mad magazine, which was a cultural shock for her. Ask that a person learns about USA from Mad magazine. But I did, because it told so many subtle things which otherwise would have taken long time for me to notice. That time now, especially in USA, everything, there was too much tension between capitalists society and communist society, you know. Also the tension Germans, Nazis and Jews had. In fact, I was doing swastika in many of my work, you know. And swastika is very respected symbol. And there almost everybody connected it with Nazi, you know. So I realized that things have very specific meaning which is related to culture, geography, everything has two sides almost. When we have two or three images, we can't just see them as separate image. We have to connect them one way or other. So it's like a novel divided into chapter. Mm-hmm. So it's a different events, different things, something is happening. Mm-hmm. And because they are on same thing, again you are forced to take it, think that they are connected. Mm-hmm. And you try to connect according to your own information about India, mm-hmm. about human being, mm-hmm. about art, whatever. So in many of the 14th, 15th centuries poems, where human body is connected with bungalow, you know, it's made of this and that, and you know, bricks are, you know, bones are bricks. So bungalow has that meaning. Before cutting, I had said Bungalow Atam Ramno. It was a Gujarati title. I had given two titles, English and Gujarati. Bungalow is literally bungalow, but means the structure, body, whatever. Of Atam Ram. Atam Ram is again a colloquial version for Atma, soul. You know. So the abode of a soul, I mean, if you translate this, Bungalow Atam Ramno would, the nearest English would be abode of a soul or the soul, if you like. But then since it was cut and few things were removed, this is what, this has remained. Something was gained and something was lost, I don't know. Since my literature knowledge is all these children's stories and such stories, folk stories, I think it keeps on coming. Because for me, this is my life. No, I don't know what is on the other side of this wall. I am wise enough to know that there is other side and there can be different things. But within my knowledge, these are the only things. And if they keep on coming, I say let people who are experts find meaning. If there is meaning, fine.